Wheels Along the Road is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.
Everybody, welcome to our November episode of Wheels Along the Road, brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. I am your host, Kendra Cook, and I'm here with Dan Olsen.
Hi there.
Hi, Dan Olsen.
Hi there out there in TV land.
We are excited to be back and refreshed from our time at Hershey.
We are.
Yeah.
Yes.
I think we're refreshed from our time at Hershey.
Oh, sure. I'm ready for next year.
So if you stopped it in said hi to us out there.
I think it's 347 days, by the way.
Just around the corner.
Or is it 37?
Really?
330s. I forget now. Okay. Anyway, yeah.
Math is not my strong suit. I don't know. But I'll take your word for it. So we had a great time at Hershey.
Mm-hmm.
And we had a great time this past Saturday at Diner Day. If you were there to join us, thank you. I think it was successful. I barely saw you.
No. You were busy.
Yeah. We had a lot of...
I was busy.
We had a lot of people interested in the museum.
Yes, I noticed
you
that.
You know,
I noticed that.
Didn't just get their coffee and pie mm-hmm. and run. They mm-hmm. were there for a long time.
Oh, yeah.
Enjoying
yep.
all the stuff.
And that's what I enjoy because, you know, the pie and coffee, that's great and mm-hmm. all that, but I enjoy talking to the visitors, and I had these great conversations. And a lot of times the conversations would start with me asking them, did you have pie?
Yeah.
You know, especially if they had kids. And
yes.
that's a good way of getting
yes.
to the conversation is, you know, hey, did you have pie? What kind did you have? Did you like it? And the whole thing.
It was a good day. So, mm-hmm. It was a good day. Mm-hmm. So if you came out, thanks. If you didn't, we don't have the next one scheduled yet, but we'll let you know when we do. So.
Mm-hmm.
Coming up at the museum, our next kind of event, I don't have too many details for you yet, but we will be opening our new carriage display area in December 16th in the evening. So stay tuned to our website and our Facebook page for that. I'll have more info at our December show too,
mm-hmm.
But hope we see you at that as well. And just so everyone knows, we're coming up on some holidays here. Boyertown Museum is normally open 7 days a week, 9:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. But in November, we will be closed on Thanksgiving Day. We'll be back open Friday, the day after, and Saturday and Sunday. So it's a good weekend to come visit with all the people that are now in your house and you don't know what to do with them.
Mm-hmm.
Bring them out to us. We'll entertain them for an hour at the museum. It's a neat time to come. If you'd like to visit us, there is our information, 85 South Walnut Street in Boyertown, Pennsylvania. If you'd like to contact us, drop us an email at mail, M-A-I-L, at boyertownmuseum.org, or call us 610-367-2090. We'd love to see you. We will also, for about the next month, be a Toys for Tots drop-off site. So bring a new unwrapped toy with you when you come visit to leave in the Toys for Tots box. And we are also always a Preston's Pantry drop-off location, too. So non-perishable food items, you can bring them by. And you don't have, although we'd love to see you come in and visit the museum. You don't mm-hmm. have to come in and pay admission in order to drop those things off if you mm-hmm. have them. Just drop them off. We'd love to accept them. And, I think that's it for my general announcements.
Okay.
Probably forgot something. Maybe I'll remember by the end of the show. So, in the meantime, I will turn it over to you.
Okay. This all started years ago, actually.
Ooh.
I came across something in an old Hot Rod magazine, and I sort of scanned the page and kind of left it there, and I revisited a little while ago, and I thought, you know what, I'm going to talk about this. So here it is. You're going to listen to me talk about this. Okay, so you could show the first thing here, and this is what I saw in an old Hot Rod magazine from the 60s. And I tried refinding that because I got a whole stack of Hot Rod magazines
from the 60s, and I couldn't.
And this is part of like a new products column they'd have. Okay, so you have that picture and a little description. And so it's always in the same area in the magazine, so it kind of went quicker than I thought, but I couldn't find it. So we see ram air intakes, and I don't know if you can read that or not, but they come from AMT Corporation, Speed and Custom Equipment Division. If any of you are familiar with AMT, you know they made kits, model car kits, by the Gillions.
Gillions.
That's one of my dad's words, Gillions.
I love it.
Yeah. Okay.
That's a lot of model car kits.
So anyway, this is made, these ram air intakes are made of high strength cycolac, okay? And it doesn't really say what they're doing, how big they are. It says, okay, fits any car with 5 1/4 inch sealed beam headlights. So I'm thinking, if you're familiar with the Ford Thunderbolt, for instance, back in the 60s, race cars, they had four headlights. They take the two center ones out and they put like a screen there, and it would be the air intake for the carburetors. Okay, and so I'm thinking that's what they're for. So anyway, that's what started the whole thing.
That little ad right there.
That little bitty ad. Let me tell you something about AMT, and I have a feeling most viewers out there are familiar with AMT. Probably made kits when you were a kid. They're still around, and you can still make kits from them and such. AMT stands for Aluminum Model Toys. It was a company out of Troy, Michigan. Started in 1948. A guy named Wes Galagly. Anyway, 1948.
West.
And his first product was 1/25th scale pre-assembled promotional car models. So the regular AMT models we all know and love, the 3-in-1 things, they were like 1/25th scale. I think 1/24th, 1/25th. So he was making promotional models, and they were for Ford dealers.
Okay.
And he would make these models and, make, and then the Ford dealers would have them, and they were, came in different colors so the salesman could show prospective customers, okay, this is what it looks like.
The actual Ford colors.
This is what it's going to, yes, actual Ford colors. And I know a while ago, those things were quite popular in flea markets. You could see them, but I haven't noticed it that much in the last 10 years or so. But anyway, that was it. The first one was like a 1948 Ford four-door sedan, and it actually was cast in aluminum. Then later on, they came out with plastic models that would actually warp, and I've seen some of those models, and they look like they've been in the oven too long, okay? So then they went to styrene, which is a better strength plastic. So AMT didn't actually make them. They came from outside companies that molded them. I guess AMT assembled them and packaged them and sent them out. And but they lasted until the 1990s, which surprised me. And then dealers actually started selling them instead of giving them away. And then they started, the car companies started licensing the model companies to use their name and everything. So it kind of stopped there. But the next step for AMT, since they already were getting into the licensing of these brand names and such, they started making the kits. And the inspiration were from people who took these promotional models and customized them to their own liking. So they said, hey, we can do that. So in 1961, AMT bought another scale model company called Scale Model Products. And prior to that, this company, SMP, was making model kits and doing the 3-in-1 different kit, and you can make 3 different versions of the same model. And I'm trying to think what they were, maybe stock, custom, and race.
Okay.
They were the 3 different things, and they had different things you could add or onto the model for that. So AMT used that mind that SMP was doing and started making it, and actually used SMP's logo from back then for their own. AMT worked with real car customizers to create some of those ideas for modeling things, such as Gene Winfield, George Barris, Alexander Brothers, some others there. Some of the models had instructions from these guys how to customize the car so you can make it look like the real thing. Mid to late 1960s, model cars or model kit sales increased. Other companies entered the market. There was a bunch of them when I was a kid. You'd go there and pretty much any kind of model car you wanted. AMT, realizing, okay, we have all these competitors, they kind of branched out into other things, including models based on TV shows and movies. Also model planes, bulldozers, NASCAR, vans, all sorts of stuff, okay? So in 1978, AMT was bought out by Lesney. I always thought it was Lenzi, or what did I think? The people who make Matchbox, okay? They bought them in 78.
All right.
But since 1978, now they've gone through a few other different companies, buying, selling, and all that stuff. There are AMT models out there with the same AMT logo, but it's a company now called Round Two. And I was on their website the other day, and yeah, there they are. So all different stuff you can get from. Okay, so that was kind of a quick history of AMT models.
Hmm.
We didn't even get to the really cool stuff yet.
Wow.
Yeah.
They're also making intakes, air intakes.
Yeah, and we're going to touch on that later.
Okay.
I guess I should have stepped back from that, because the air intakes was a division of AMT called Speed and Custom Equipment. And that's pretty much the gist of my talk here. Gist. Double word score.
Two.
Okay. Early 1960s, there's a company out there called Marbon, M-A-R-B-O-N, Chemical, and ended up becoming part of Borg Warner. They made a unique plastic called Psycholac, which those intakes were made out of also, okay? They wanted to promote that plastic for cars. So they decided, why don't we have a car made out of plastic? And so that's what they did. The plastic was tough, hard, and rigid. And in fact, two of the first major products made from that company, or made from that material of that company, were RCA radios and telephones. So you're way too young for this, but the old dial phone was made of this clunky, hard black plastic, and that was Psycholac.
Interesting.
Yeah. Okay.
We grew up with a rotary phone.
Really? Okay.
My parents
that's
still
right.
Still have it.
You lived out in the country, sort of.
Yeah.
Did you have to call the operator first? Never. Don't even get.
No, but I did know how to dial it. I know some people in my age are like, how do you even dial this?
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah,
a while.
I can.
You know,
okay.
It's nice.
How about that? Okay. So Marbon in the early 60s. Marbon Chemical hired a race car engineer called Dan Deaver of Centaur Engineering to design a 2-seat roadster with a rear-mounted engine in it. So that's what he did. And it was called the CRV for Psycholac Research Vehicle. And it was built around a tubular race car frame from Centaur. Body was made of 2 pieces of vacuum-formed Psycholac plastic. The top half was formed in place. There was bucket seats, console, armrest, dashboard, that sort of stuff. The bottom half had the fenders, wheel wells, and full underpan, like the floor and such. So that was all that. And there's pictures of it online I saw, and the pictures weren't that great, but you can kind of get a pretty good idea what's going on there. The first one was powered by a four-cylinder Sunbeam engine, and then after that they went to a Corvair engine. So it was so popular, I guess, in shows and stuff, they decided to build a second one called CRV2. And they decided for durability testing, they're gonna race it. So you can show the next picture, you'll see CRV2, and kind of a little thing there. Okay, so they used it in SCCA sports car racing, and actually won its class in 1965. And it even survived a wreck. So that was the durability thing. After that, they made a CRV3. It was built and destroyed on purpose for mandated crash testing. So they were testing it because, you know, I guess it was all proof because they didn't really want to get into the car business, but they wanted to promote their product. Uh-huh. And I guess if you had a car made out of their thing, so hey, look at this.
Extras.
We can run this thing off a cliff and it still survives.
Wow.
I don't know what the testing actually was. 1966 CRV4 and 5 were built. They both went overseas promoting plastic again by this company. So after that, AMT, here's AMT again, they purchased the rights from Marvin and bought its inventory of plastic bodies. I don't know how many plastic bodies there were there. So at the same time, AMT started this speed and custom equipment division out in Phoenix, Arizona. Okay, it was established, you know, I have a word established here. I don't think it was established by him, but he was the production manager, Gene Winfield. We mentioned him earlier as a car customizer.
Yes.
Yeah. Matt's friends with him.
Oh.
Yeah. Okay.
Another friend.
Anyway, so he was the production manager. Gene Winfield was a customizer from California. But he led the division to design and build these plastic sports cars. They changed the name of it to Piranha. Okay, so they went from CRV, which is boring, and Piranha, which is kind of exciting.
That sounds like something I want to see.
And so they did that. And the main reason for the speed and custom equipment division was to promote products and to manufacture templates for construction molds for parts and so on and so forth. And they kind of have an interesting thing, and that's where it gets, this is where the cool stuff starts. Okay, so one of the things they were doing was TV vehicles.
Okay.
For instance, Get Smart.
He drove a Sunbeam Tiger, at least.
Very good.
Yeah. Very at least good. One that's season right.
Sunbeam.
He did.
Okay, it was used in the opening shots of seasons 1 and 2.
Okay.
It was a Sunbeam Tiger.
Yes.
And that had stuff on it made by this company. And and I think they took an actual car and they just customized it in this division of AMT. It was used throughout the series in various episodes. And then what I saw online, it says, symbolically at least. Okay, because they actually ended up using a Sunbeam Alpine. Okay, Sunbeam Tigers had a V8 engine in. Sunbeam Alpines had a four-cylinder.
Okay.
And to put, they had a cannon in the car.
Yeah.
And it was under the hood. And to fit that in, you had to have the smaller engine. So that was that. So, okay.
I think he had ejector seats too, but that doesn't.
Yeah, they had a bunch of stuff. That was a bunch of stuff. But the cannon was
the cannon,
cool
yes.
Ejector seats, you know. You see James Bond, you see them too. Actually, I had that model. James Bond car with the ejector seats.
Yeah.
Okay, anyway. You can show the next picture here, and this is another car by them.
Okay? Oh my goodness.
And this is the reactor, and it's the Bewitched car.
It so there we sure see. Sure is.
We see Darren and
Samantha.
Samantha, thank you. That's why you're here
That's
today.
That's why I'm here.
Okay.
I'm in fact checking.
So
today.
So that car was used, and wow. And apparently I was reading the reason for this car in there, and he was all excited about it, and what was Samantha's mom's name?
Andorra.
Andorra. She wanted to impress him, so she got this car for him. And anyway, and of course, oh it ended gosh. Up as a whole mess.
Oh, yes.
So that car was used there. But then I found out that car was used in other shows also. It was used in Batman. They okay. put other decorations on it, and Catwoman had it.
Okay.
They put a nose and a tail, and it was goofy looking. How about Mission Impossible?
Oh, it kind of looks like a Mission Impossible okay. car, doesn't it?
Here's another one, The Flying Nun. The Flying Nun. So there's a part in this where Carlos from The Flying Nun was showing Sister Bertrell, who's Sally Field, uh-huh. a car in a magazine. Okay? Yes. The cover has that car on it. The car, you know, so yeah. they have this car magazine. That's yeah. it. All right.
Wow.
It's the same magazine Darren was reading in the Bewitched episode. Isn't that interesting? I thought that
Glad
was.
Glad they kept that in the vault
yes,
for later.
Yes. Yeah. And I figured you would like that. Okay. Okay. That car also was used in Star Trek. Okay.
It was?
Yeah. It told me what episode, but I'm thinking, okay, we don't need to know that. And there's
I
a picture. There's
now.
A picture of that car online, and it shows Captain Kirk.
Yeah.
Kind of leaning against it.
Yes.
Kind of sitting on the front tire.
Yes, I have seen that picture. Oh, so, that's this car.
Yes.
Look
so
at
that had a lot of TV time, almost as much as you and I. So anyway, Star Trek. There was an agreement between AMT and Gene Roddenberry,
okay,
who mm-hmm. was the producer, director.
Great Bird of the Galaxy.
Okay.
Yes.
And AMT was given exclusive rights to manufacture model kits based on the new Star Trek TV series.
Oh, boy.
Right? In return for helping out Desilu Studios with construction of set pieces, which included the Klingon D7 class battle starship
oh, yes.
model.
I wonder okay. if it cloaks.
And wonder if it what?
Klingons and Romulans can cloak their ships so they oh. go invisible.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. This is why I'm here today, folks.
Yeah, folks. She's the Star Trek person. I'm not. Okay. Construction of a full-scale exterior and interior model of the Galileo 7, including a scaled model for filming. See, and I've seen pictures of that. It's
yes.
the full thing. That kind of looks like a van, right?
It kind does,
like
sort
a box
of. Yeah.
Thing. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So they got that. Now, they also did with the model kits. Remember, they were given exclusive rights for these kits. And remember uh-huh. earlier I said they expanded away from cars and
yeah.
trying to expand
yeah.
the thing. Starship Enterprise. Isn't that the one that
That's their
Captain
ship?
Kirk's always uh-huh. hanging out on uh-huh. stuff? Okay.
yes.
That was one of AMT's best-selling kits.
That doesn't surprise me. Where else would you get one?
Other Star Trek kits. 1/12 scale of Spock fighting the three-headed alien. And Romulan bird of prey ship.
Ooh, those are... I have a Romulan bird of prey ship, but it is not from AMT. It's
okay.
Modern.
Okay,
it's got
so
a bird painted on it.
So
cool.
all this was happening in 1966, 67. There's some other car kits you could get. You could get one of Maxwell Smart's Sunbeam Tiger. This is a kit for $2.
Was that his red car?
Yeah, it was a little red car.
He had like three cars.
Yeah, he had three or four.
Throughout
yeah,
the
there,
show.
There's a website that goes yeah. on every one of the cars and talks about it. The Spaceship Enterprise was $1.70.
I'm there.
Yeah.
I'll pay $1.70.
And there was another show called The Cat, T-H-E, abbreviated Cat. So I don't know what that is. But they had a model of that. And then My Mother, the Car, you can get one of them. the Munster coach, Dragula. Okay, some others there. All right, that's that.
I would like to have a My Mother the Car model.
You want the real thing in a museum.
Yeah, I really do, actually. Yeah, figured that. I put it there.
Okay. So let's go back to this Piranha car, okay?
Yeah.
We sort of drifted away from that. So this car that was called CRV, AMT got the rights to it. They changed the name to Piranha. They were committed to build 50 units a year, but they only built like six of them or something. The interest wasn't there, and they had Corvair engines in it. It was a rear engine vehicle, so the Corvair engine, they quit making Corvairs, so that mm-hmm. was, they just stopped. But they did make some interesting other vehicles. And you can show the next picture. Okay, oh, there he is. That's Robert
it's
Vaughn.
It's Robert Vaughn.
The man from Uncle had it.
Oh,
and
I wonder if that's Ilya's arm there that was cut off.
It could have been. And I had another picture, and it had the girl from Uncle. Which was who?
Oh, gosh. Mm-hmm. Now you've stumped me.
Stephanie Powers.
Oh, my Lord.
Okay. And it has her in another picture. But there was a Girl from Uncle TV show, too.
Yes,
so
it was.
They were in various shows and such. And
is that the door? It's like gold wing
doors? Yeah, that's
doors.
The door. They made gold wing doors. But most pictures you see don't even have a roof or doors on it.
Wow.
Okay. So that was a special one that they made. So apparently Winfield had a lot of TV connections, Gene Winfield. So that's how that car made it into to there. So, okay, next picture is yet another Piranha car, totally different. This is a dragster.
Wow.
Actually, this is called a funny car. It's 120-inch wheelbase.
Funny?
40-inch, yeah, funny. And, but whereas back then, this is 1967, they were still using full-bodied regular cars, maybe tweaked. They were tweaked a lot, but still
wow.
they look like regular cars. So this is a lot different. This had a blown Chrysler engine in it. It was a full race car, and it ran a full match race schedule, went up to 190 miles an hour. Best of 193, but somewhere along the way, AMT, they own that car. They gave it to somebody else for a short while. I guess loan would be a better word. And they got it up to 197. That was the top speed for that car.
Hmm.
They sold the Piranha after that to the Hara collection out in Reno, Nevada. Went through various owners. Now Don mm-hmm. Garlitz owns that car. So that's
sharp looking.
Pretty
I like
neat.
It.
It is. It is. And there's pictures. There, you could get a model of that. And I did have a picture of the box of that model. And
wow.
it shows it racing, you know, the smoke's coming off the tires and everything. It's cool. But this is just a better picture here.
And
so
it's got Psycholac on the side.
Okay.
It says.
I believe you.
It
I
does.
Can't see it from here.
And thermoplastic.
Okay. All right. So that is all about that, and this is something, you know, this goes all the way back to the Ram air intakes as far as getting stuff for your streetcar. So the next picture you're going to see is an advertisement for a brochure for AMT Corporation Speed and Custom Division.
Hmm.
And you see, that's three Camaros sitting there, and they are 67 Camaros, 1967, with different optional accessories on them. And it says somewhere in the brochure, this exciting new Camaro accessories program is now available to all Camaro owners through their Chevrolet dealers. So you can buy these parts from your Chevy dealer, which I never heard of. I asked a friend about it. He never heard of it, so it's pretty interesting there. So you could show the next picture, and this is part of the brochure.
Ooh.
And the next one, too. There's oh, wait a minute. Don't show the next one yet. Go ahead. Show the next one. I'm sorry. So that's the page. If you see the words at the top, they run together. So So there you go. You got hood scoops, you got fender flares, you got side scoops on it, you got a spoiler in the back and everything. And they have all sorts of stuff you can add to your Camaro there. And so like the side scoops, if you wanted to buy a set of them, just one of them. If you want to buy two of them, obviously it's twice this price, but $13.98.
Oh boy.
You get, I'm trying to think, fender flares for a whole set of them is $95, and the hood scoop for the hood, yeah. It's $27, almost $28. So you could get all these different things.
Wow.
I've never seen anything like this except what I found on line here. And I thought, wow, that is cool. You know, all my time I spent roaming the aisles at Hershey,
yeah,
never saw any of these parts, any of the advertisements, nothing. And it's really neat. And I came across this, some information on this, on a model car site, because, you know, the AMT,
right,
that connection. And I'm thinking, and that's about it. It's just really interesting. But you could get side pipes from that, real side pipes that cost almost $250. You can get wheels for it, mag wheels for these. Pretty much customize your 67 Camaro.
Wow.
And that was pretty cool. Okay. So you can show the next thing here, the next one. Okay, that's the front cover of it, so it's showing a nice color.
Oh, that's a great bit of artwork there.
Yeah.
I like that.
So you can see the hood scoops on it, you can see the side scoops, you can see the exhaust pipe and stuff and special paint on that.
Wow.
And yeah, that's that. So that was the accessories, the exciting new Camaro accessories. That was for 1967. Anyway, the company hung around for a little while longer. 1969, they relocated to California. In 1970, Gene Winfield left the company for his own projects, okay? 1971, AMT closed down the speed and custom shop. There was a recession nationwide, and so they said, okay, that's about it. And so that was pretty much it. Now, I mentioned off and on about some of these kits that are out there.
Mm-hmm.
I looked up in the Piranha Dragster kit. They're making them now. You can buy brand new ones, okay, recently made. And online, like eBay, they go anywhere from $11 to $27, which is, okay. The original ones can be up to like $250, I found.
Oh, wow.
Them. So that's pretty interesting. The Super Spy car from Man of Uncle, $250 if you want an original. And the new ones online are like $18 to $30 in that range. So anyway, that's it. That's the story about the AMT Corporation Speed and Custom Division and a quick romp through TV land.
Yes, huh? I always like to romp through TV land.
Yeah, so.
I love how they were making like toys.
Mm-hmm.
And then like actual racing accessories, like that was their two things.
Mm-hmm.
I like it.
Okay.
Very nice.
That's it.
All right. Ooh. I'm going to have to hunt down like that episode of Bewitched now.
I'm sure you will.
I count on me. I will.
Mm-hmm.
And I have homework to do on the Star Trek one.
I'm sure you will do that too.
And I never heard of the cat either.
Yeah. THE is abbreviated again. It stands for something.
So the T dot H dot.
Correct.
Oh.
Like uncle, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
I never heard of that. But I want to watch it now. Just like I wanted to watch Good Times.
Yeah. Okay. Forgot about that.
Oh my.
Is that your son out there?
So, wow, there's like a gaggle of school kids outside.
One gaggle.
You know, one gaggle. Coming right up. Okay. This is also something that I came across a couple years ago now, I think. And I've just been slowly adding to it. We have a web series for the museum on YouTube. So after you're done watching this on YouTube, you can go check out the museum's YouTube channel. And if you recall, it's probably 2 years ago now, I talked about the Chesapeake Bay Bridge Tunnel.
I remember that.
He does. I gave you
that look because I was actually thinking of doing going on that.
Oh, yeah?
Next week.
But I love
it's probably not. It's a little too far out of my way.
Yeah. I love the Chesapeake Bay Bridge Tunnel.
Okay.
It's cool. So when I was looking at that, I found like another odd bridge in a different part of the world. And then I just kept accumulating these interesting bridges. So we're going to go on a world tour.
Okay.
Of some unique bridges. So we're going to start in the Netherlands. And full disclosure, I'm going to probably horribly butcher most of the names. That. So this is the Natuurbrug Zanderij Krijlo.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah, you've mm-hmm. heard of that. So it translates to Sand Quarry Natural Bridge. So there's actually two here. So closer to the top, there's like that's actually a rail overpass there at the top. Those are rail lines. And then there is a smaller road kind of in the middle of your screen, right before you, right like above that river, sort of, the water, and that's the
okay.
for cars.
Okay.
So
the rail is going left to right, right?
Yeah, they're both parallel.
Okay, mm-hmm. got it.
So what this is, and here's the car and bike overpass. It's essentially a land bridge over the road
mm-hmm.
to allow wildlife to cross the road and not get hit.
Mm-hmm.
And since we're in Pennsylvania and it's November, we know that that's happening a lot right now. Lots of deer are victims of cars and trucks right now. So this is the longest one in the Netherlands. It's 800 meters long and 50 meters wide. But the Netherlands has over 600 of these. And Netherlands is not big, so that's a lot.
So I'm looking at that, and that bridge you're talking about is going up
yep.
the center there.
Yep.
And I see like a little road. Is that like a little maintenance road type thing?
I believe so, because it is, because you're not, you can be fined for going up there and like sightseeing. Because if too many people are going up there, then the animals won't use it, which totally defeats the purpose of mm-hmm. building it. Mm-hmm. So they call these eco ducts, but it's, you know, to let deer and actually, apparently the European badger, which is endangered, that's another one that they're trying to really save with these, to cross over the roads and not get hit by cars or trains. There's some wildlife hanging out.
It's called an eco duct.
An eco duct.
Looks like an eco cow.
Yes. This particular one opened in 2006. It was completed. But they started building these a little bit ago. The first one opened in 1988, and they've built like 600 more since. So that's what these are for. So now we are going to leave the Netherlands, and we're going to go to Germany, its Ooh. Neighbor. This is just a fun one. This is in Wuppertal, Germany, and it's called the Lego Bridge. So the Wuppertal, this started as a train route, actually. The Wuppertal Northern Railway was created in 1879. It was supposed to compete with another, a large railway at the time called the BME. And unfortunately, the BME was already around for 30 years and had really the best routes and already had staked out like the easiest way to get from points A to point B, you know, with the geography and stuff. So The Wuppertal Northern Railway never did catch up. By the 1990s, everything that it had built was abandoned. But nobody wants abandoned tracks, right? They want to make use of those.
No. Don't want that.
So they start to like repair them and use them for other things. So it's a bike path, really, now. It's for bicycling. And the city of Wuppertal wanted it to look a little nicer. So they hired this artist, Megix, to pretty it up. And he said he was, you know, watching his daughter build things with Legos and said, well, that, you know, she's building bridges all the time. Let's make this look like a Lego bridge. So we got permission from Lego to do this. And this is what it looks like now. And just one of the revitalized. So not terribly fancy, but prettied up. Now we're going to leave Europe. We're going to go to Uruguay.
Wow.
Yeah. The Circular Laguna Garzon Bridge in Garzon, Uruguay. So this was designed by a Uruguayan architect named Rafael Vinoli. And what is the point of this circle? Because it's really not a terribly long span.
No.
At all. The point is really to make the drivers slow down. This is really the whole purpose of this. It also has a pedestrian walkway with crosswalks. You can see the crosswalks where the road branches off. This is replacing a ferry system.
Oh, that's boring.
Yeah. Which I guess still operates minimally right now. But before, the only way to get across this lake was to take a vehicle or to take a ferry that really only held two vehicles at a time, and it would only operate in daytime. And if the weather was bad, it wouldn't operate at all. So that's really not efficient whatsoever. So the bridge was completed in 2015. About 1,000 vehicles use it a day, which really is not that many. And
but that equals 500 ferry trips.
That's a lot of ferry trips instead. That you can see, it's not exactly like the most built up area, but they spent $10 million to build this. Now,
that's just kind of neat looking.
It is really cool looking. It was not financed really by the Uruguayan government. It was financed by an Argentinian real estate developer, Eduardo Costantini. Why would he do this?
Gee, I don't know. It looks like undeveloped land right now.
Yes. Well, he was building a block of holiday rental units.
Because I'm assuming off on the left is like the ocean or similar
to
that.
Yeah, there's this from
now
the other angle.
Move to the right. How'd they do that?
Yeah, I think that's the ocean there and then this
ocean
lake.
Oceanfront property.
Uh-huh. So he wants to build these rental units there, and of course, that's not going to do with a two vehicle at a time ferry.
Right.
So he had this built, and he also pushed for the pedestrian because people on holiday, can walk. And I think also the fact that it's unique, it's just another reason to go see it, you know?
Yeah, I'm planning on going
That's
to see
right.
it now.
Book your tickets now.
Yeah.
450 tons of steel, 500 cubic meters of concrete, and 40,000 meters of cable. So a lot of material and time went on this. Now, the architect, he's an interesting fellow. He did some interesting stuff. But this is what he says about it. The point of it was, quote, to transform a traditional vehicular crossing into an event that reduces the speed of the cars to provide an opportunity to enjoy panoramic views to an amazing landscape and at the same time create a pedestrian place in the center. Hmm. I have to point out something else that he built, which just made me laugh. So Vinoli also designed the walkie-talkie building in London, which is interesting. Oh. First of all, it looks like a walkie-talkie by the shape of it. It has two nicknames.
Okay.
The Walkie Scorchy and the Fryscaper.
Okay.
Because the glare off of this is supposedly so bad that it melted cars.
It looks like it melted itself.
It does look melted. He's been known to say, well, yeah, there were errors in that.
Oh, yeah.
But I thought that was funny. I had to include that. All right. We're leaving Uruguay, and we're going to Vietnam. And this is the Dragon Bridge, obviously, in Da Nang, Vietnam. This one looks to me is the coolest. It opened in 2013, and it was actually designed by a New York-based architect, and it cost $85 million to build this bridge. The dragon design is is modeled after ones from 11th and 12th centuries that were popular in Vietnam. It shoots fire and sprays water at times, but they close the bridge to traffic when it does that, so don't worry. You won't get your car lit on fire.
Well, I can think of accidents happening.
Yeah, rubbernecking.
Oh, yeah.
A lot of rubbernecking if that goes on.
Did you see that?
That's it all lit up at night, which is pretty cool. Like the dragon arches, the scales you can see arching over there. The steel arch of the back is 568 meters long. So in total, this bridge is 2,185 feet long. Pretty big bridge. It connects their airport to like where the population centers are, like the beach in the downtown area. Mm-hmm. Dragons in Vietnamese folklore are supposed to go to the sea and then return with good luck. So that's why he's part of the bridge. He's got lovely heart eyes. That's him all lit up.
And spouting flame.
Spouting fire. They change the colors based on festivals and the time of year.
Must be St. Patrick's Day.
That's so right. And there he's spraying water. So he does both. Okay, not in the same part of the world, same continent, Japan. This one's going to look kind of boring at first. So this is the Ashima Ohashi Bridge. It's a rigid frame bridge over the Nakuomi Lake. Took 7 years to build, from 1997 to 2004. So a rigid frame means the superstructure and the substructure are rigidly connected into like one unit. This is the third largest rigid frame bridge in the world. It's about a mile long, and at its tallest point, it's 44 meters tall, which allows the ships to go underneath it because no one likes a drawbridge. It replaced a drawbridge. This is one of the busiest fishing areas in Japan. So that drawbridge was up all the time and it was gumming up the works. So they built this to replace it. But why is it even considered unique? That is one angle where this is like a viral sensation because it creates this like optical illusion of being a lot steeper than it is.
Mm-hmm.
That right there looks pretty bad to me, but it's actually never worse than a 6.1% grade. So that means for every 100 feet that it travels horizontally, it at the most only goes up 6.1 feet.
Which is
really nothing, but there are certain angles.
Looks like a roller coaster.
It does. That's what they call it, the roller coaster bridge. There's a website, a Japanese tourism website, and this is, I love this, quote, to get the, quote, craziest angle for your photo, You need to take it from, quote, the convenience store at the intersection on the Shimani side.
Okay.
So, and I've read people's accounts that are taking this bridge, and they say, like, driving towards it on the one side especially, it looks like the road just goes up and ends.
Mm-hmm.
But it really is not that bad. But it's an optical illusion that it creates. It was popularized by the Daihatsu Motor Company in Japan because they filmed commercials for their minivan on this bridge.
Okay.
And they were like really making use, maximizing that optical Got illusion it. To make their minivan look rugged. Does he look rugged to you?
No, it doesn't.
All right. I'm going to do one more. We'll go to China. And this is the Tianjin Eye. So this is a 120-meter tall Ferris wheel over the Yongle Bridge, which crosses the He River in China. They built this in 2007. Didn't even take a full year to build it. It's an electric Ferris wheel, and it has 48 passenger cars, and each car holds 8 people. It takes 30 minutes to do a full rotation.
What, how big is that again?
120 meters tall. At the time, it was the 4th tallest Ferris wheel in the world. I'm still not going on it. I hate Ferris wheels. Don't really want to go on.
At first, I thought it was just a loop-de-loop. When you're driving, you go.
Yeah. Oh, gosh, like the super-duper looper at Hershey Park.
You got it. Well, I was thinking driving your car, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, actually, if you walk to the Ferris wheel, take a ride on it, get off, and then walk to the other side of the bridge, like, and it, if the Ferris wheel does that and it's at full capacity, it actually would move more people over the bridge in an hour than driving.
Huh. Okay.
If it ran continuously and at full capacity. But the Ferris wheel operates from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. every day, except Monday. That's when it gets maintenance done. And it is recommended to get your tickets ahead of time because it sells out. So make sure you order your tickets, Dan, before you get on there. I would not go on there at all. Okay. We are out of time for this month, but that is a quick tour of some odd bridges around the world and our detour into TV land and cycolac plastic and AMT.
Mm-hmm.
And we thank you all at home for joining us here in November, and we look forward to seeing you in December. Please take time to visit us at the museum. We would love to see you. Remember that we are closed on Thanksgiving Day, but we will be open Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and Monday. A lot of people have Monday off, too, for Thanksgiving. We'll be open. We would love to see you then. It's a great time to bring your family and your out-of-town guests. And until then, we will see you next time. Thanks, everyone.
Wheels Along the Road is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.